The local education freedom accounts is a big bang. When that bill was in committee, it was a very spicy debate between legislators.
From reproductive rights to affordable housing, state lawmakers have hundreds of proposals to consider next year. We'll look at some of those bills and what they mean for New Hampshire residents next on The State We're In. Hello, welcome to The State We're In. I'm Melanie Plenda. As we head into 2022, state lawmakers will be considering hundreds of proposals for new laws and constitutional amendments. They cover everything from legalizing marijuana to fresh condiments at a hot dog stand. Here to discuss some of these proposals is Anna Brown, Director of Research and Analysis for Citizens Count, a nonprofit dedicated to providing objective information about issues and candidates. Welcome, Anna.
Great to be back, Melanie.
Great to have you. So there are more than 600 bills currently up for consideration. There are a lot of proposals we see returning for another discussion, as well as a few new topics like condiments. Why condiments?
So you must be talking about HB 1095. That would require the state to make rules allowing the sale of fresh condiments at hot dog stands. And the bill specifically mentions sauerkraut, chili, cheese, beans, and fresh vegetables. It's the type of bill that really sounds like it has a story behind it, and I'll definitely be tuning into the public hearings to hear all about it.
We will definitely follow up with you on that one. So let's start with talking about elections. There are several proposals that would change voting rules. Can you summarize a few of those proposals?
These bills are very much still coming out of the controversy that President Donald Trump started in 2020, saying that there's widespread election fraud. I will say Governor Sununu, Secretary of State Bill Gardner all say that there is no evidence of widespread fraud in New Hampshire, but there's a lot of bills that are looking to tighten up the process in one way or another. So looking thematically, we have several bills related to requiring paper ballots. New Hampshire does use paper ballots, but these bills would require paper ballots, such as CACR 19, a constitutional amendment that would do this. Other bills that would require hand counting, which would eliminate the use of electronic vote counting machines, because those also controversy around those, as we know. Election audits, several bills would require those, everything from a bill, HB 1467, that would require partial audits after every election, just kind of checking in, to Representative Tim Baxter requesting a full audit of the entire 2020 general election in New Hampshire. Also things around provisional ballots or other restrictions for people who vote and register on the same day at the polls. There's concern about that. There have been Supreme Court cases related to voter registration requirements. And then a little kind of off the beaten path, there are also several bills related to ranked choice voting in New Hampshire. And I don't know if those would necessarily get very far, but it's certainly we've seen it emerging in New York, for example, as maybe in a totally new voting system that might come forward someday in New Hampshire.
Just for folks who might not understand what that is, can you just briefly explain what is ranked choice voting?
So when we vote in New Hampshire, you pick one person that you want for that office, or if it's a state representative seat, for example, where you have multiple people that all represent you in your district, you can vote for as many people as would represent you. Ranked choice voting allows you to literally say, this is my first choice, this is my second choice, this is my third choice. And then it uses a system to sort of combine everyone's preferences, eliminating the least popular people as you go until you get more or less a compromise winner, based on that, once again, the ranking that everyone gives. And so it's very innovative. I think that it's people like the idea that it would be a way to sort of get rid of a little bit of the two-party bummer choice where you feel like you don't like either of your candidate choices. But it is complex and harder for voters to understand. So like I said, I think it's going to take a little while before it really catches on.
So of the bills you talked about, which ones do you think have a chance of coming to a vote?
I definitely think that there will be some bill related to post-election audits. I'm not sure that New Hampshire's legislature is going to pass a bill that does a 2020 audit again, because that would be expensive. There's logistical considerations. But Secretary of State Bill Gardner has signaled that he's open to the idea of regularly doing sort of partial check-in audits in elections going forward. This is something that does exist in other states. So there's processes in place And it's honestly already a little similar to what happens with our recounts. If you think about that, they're kind of like mini audits. Every time someone wants to recount, because it's a close race, all the paper ballots go to the Secretary of State in Concord, and you look through them one by one and compare it to the machine counts. I also think there will be some changes related to voter registration requirements, because the New Hampshire Supreme Court did recently strike down the stricter requirements passed in 2018. Republican legislators have said they're interested in coming up with new proposals related to voters proving their residency. Obviously, Democrats in the chamber are hoping to just keep things more open and say that we don't need to have these really complex, confusing registration requirements.
There are also several proposals related to education, including teaching about critical race theory and allowing parents to review course material to lodge their objections. Can you talk about those?
So a little bit of background first for a reminder. As part of the state 2021 budget package, Governor Sununu signed a law aimed at banning the teaching of critical race theory in public schools. It did not mention critical race theory by name. Had broader language around race and discrimination, et cetera. So the debate now is, does this law suppress classroom conversations about the history of racism and current events, or does it not go far enough? Is the language need to be more specific? There's actually even a lawsuit on the way that's been filed that's saying the law is vague and infringes on free speech, et cetera. So the legislature is definitely going to weigh in on this issue next year. As you noted, there are some laws that are generally about giving parents more ability to intervene, I would guess you could say, in course materials and course process. So, for example, HB 1015 would require teachers to give parents 2 weeks' notice of all course materials and let them object. That would sort of be a step beyond what the state already does, which it does allow parents to pull their students from any course material that they find objectionable. And then there has to be a negotiation of what the student will be doing instead. But this would specifically give the 2 weeks notice. And then there are other bills that would basically set up public inspection available at any time of curriculum materials. Specifically though, if we're looking at that critical race theory piece, HB 1255 would get very specific, prohibiting certain things that a teacher could not say or teach in a classroom. So for example, it says, and I quote, teacher could not advocate any doctrine or theory promoting a negative account or representation of the founding and history of the United States of America in New Hampshire public schools, which does not include the worldwide context of now outdated and discouraged practices. Such prohibition includes, but is not limited to, teaching that the United States was founded on racism, and teachers who violated the law would be subject to discipline from the state. So this actually revises a law that goes way back in history. We think of this critical race theory debate as something very new, but this bill is amending a law that passed during the McCarthy era and was specifically concerned about communism spreading. And so this is a debate that is not new. It even sparked a Supreme Court case, Sweezy versus New Hampshire, that went all the way up U.S. Supreme Court. That was about a lecturer at UNH who contributed to socialist magazines.
And it sounds like just in the reading, in the snippet that you read, it sounds, the more specific, like the original House bill that went forward that became known as the Divisive Concepts Bill that failed. Is it pretty much the same, just more specific?
It's definitely more specific. The law that ultimately passed as part of the state budget generally said that teachers couldn't teach that one race is superior to another, for example. So it was really couched in the language of the state's anti-discrimination laws already. This gets much more specific. It's talking about, all right, when you talk about the history of the United States, when you talk about racism in the United States, that word racism doesn't appear in the, as you noted, it's sort of shorthand called the Divisive Concepts Law. Quick sidebar. That's because the original bill included the phrase divisive concepts. The final version of the law doesn't include the phrase divisive concepts, but it's become very common shorthand when we're talking about this new law. So yes, HB 1255, this 2022 bill we're talking about, definitely gets more specific. And because it's also saying that, all right, anytime you teach any of this, anything negative about America, basically the history of the United States, you'd have to put it in this larger worldwide context. So what would that mean exactly? How would that look? A lot of the concern about the current law has been, well, we don't know what we can or can't teach because it's subjective. How do you interpret that? Is there going to be a witch hunt? So some teachers say we just stop talking about race and the history of race in the United States altogether. Of course, you do have parents on the other side who say, you know, I don't want my kid being indoctrinated to my teacher's way of thinking about the world. So
there are also several proposals dealing with education freedom accounts. What do those cover?
Once again, quick review to get everyone, make sure on the same page. The 2021 state budget included this quote unquote education freedom accounts program, which shorthand, it's similar to a voucher program. Technically, they're different, but basically it allows a student to apply for their share of per pupil school funding and use it as a scholarship for homeschooling, private schooling, other education expenses like maybe uniforms or computers. So there's criticism that there's a third party administering the accounts, that maybe there's not enough oversight of where the money is going. So we've seen a trend of 2022 bills coming out that are adding additional requirements or audited related to this third party provider and where the money is going. So for example, HB 1120 would add requirements for education providers that get those scholarship funds. For example, they'd have to complete background checks for all employees who have direct contact with students. There's also a proposal for a big expansion or revision of the program, which is actually coming from a 2021 bill. Education committee members were working on this bill over the summer, and it would set up quote-unquote local education freedom accounts. School funding in New Hampshire includes a state portion and a local portion, which it makes up your local property tax bill, really. So it's going to vary a lot from town to town how much they're giving to their local schools. And HB 607 would allow students to apply for that local share of funding. There are other differences to the program. For example, 60% of voters in the district would have to approve it. But the gist is, once again, students would be able to get local funds as opposed to state funds. And that's going to come up for a vote right away when the legislature gets back in session January 5th, 6th, and 7th.
And which of those proposals do you expect to attract a lot of interest?
The local education freedom accounts is a big bang. When that bill was in committee, it was a very spicy debate between legislators. There are opponents who say that this is going to really threaten school funding in New Hampshire. And there's some fiscal questions because there wasn't a fiscal note with the bill at that time, which is basically a financial analysis of what's this going to do at the state level, at the local level with money. So it's going to be a very, very hot debate. In terms of those other changes to the program, in terms of adding other requirements or audits, I think that some of those maybe could pass, but I do think there will be a lot of resistance from the majority of Republicans in the legislature to change the program until it's run for a year. This is the first year the program exists. It was only passed back in June. So I think that for a lot of people, they kind of want to wait and see, all right, before we look for problems, let's get a lay of the land and see how it goes forward. So like I said, local accounts are going to be a really hot debate, but I'm not sure that there's going to be legislative will to really dramatically change the program in the first year.
So switching gears a little bit, there are also bills dealing with reproductive rights. Those are also likely to attract attention. What can you tell us about those?
Abortion is a huge issue in the United States right now, and New Hampshire has not escaped that in any way. So there are several 2022 bills that are coming out that look at all sides of the issue, really. CACR 18 would create a constitutional right to make reproductive decisions. So that would probably block various abortion restrictions that could come down the pipe in the future. And then on the other side, you have bills that would decrease abortion access in different ways. So for example, HB 1181 would allow a father to petition to block an abortion. HB 1477 would ban abortion after a fetal heartbeat. Also worth noting that HB 622 is another 2021 bill that got a rewrite over the summer, kind of like the bill, local education freedom account we were talking about. So this bill was rewritten to repeal an abortion ultrasound mandate that was passed once again as part of last year's state budget. So that is also going to be a debate that hits very quickly right away in January.
And what are their chances of passing? What do you think Governor Sununu's response is going to be?
Governor Sununu is in a very tricky place in regard to abortion. He has always identified as a pro-choice governor, but he's gotten a lot of heat for signing a 24-week abortion ban as part of the 2021 state budget package. And that 24-week abortion ban included that ultrasound requirement. So I think that Governor Sununu could probably put a little bit of chill on any Republican momentum that they want to pass abortion restrictions, because I think Governor Sununu, if he really maintains his pro-choice, is going to veto a bill that, for example, bans abortion after a fetal heartbeat. If he signed it, I think that he could never claim that he was pro-choice again, really, because that would be a very, very strict abortion restriction. That being said, I think that he would be open to signing a bill that repeals the transvaginal ultrasound mandate. And the trick there is going to be, are there enough Republicans to support that repeal? There is at least one Republican. So he was on the committee evaluating this revised bill, HB 622. And he said that, all right, the doctors are already doing these if needed. We don't need the requirement, but let's just do the repeal. Because also this could potentially impact costs, which are something that insurance costs are something that Republicans definitely have had an eye on. So that might be able to eke through and get a signature from Sununu. Other major changes, I think that it would be a very intense debate. But like I said, I think that it might have trouble passing the Senate, especially if Governor Sununu came out and said, I won't sign that.
Tell me a little bit about the proposal to make insurrection or rebellion grounds to exclude someone from state office.
There's a lot of interesting context around this bill. Obviously, the insurrection on January 6th is at the forefront of many people's minds, but this bill is actually very specifically in response to something in New Hampshire. Many people may be familiar with the Free State Movement in New Hampshire, and there is a corresponding constitutional amendment proposed this year, CACR 32, that would declare New Hampshire's independence from the United States and basically secede. We would secede as a state. So that is sponsored by Rep. Mike Sylvia, a Republican from Belmont. So HB 1007 would say that if you engage in insurrection or rebellion, you're ineligible to run for office. And it's very clear that insurrection or rebellion includes advocating for New Hampshire to secede. So it's sort of like two bills that are warring with each other. And I think it's interesting to note that HB 1007 is sponsored by Rep. William Marsh. He is a doctor from Wolfboro, and he left the Republican Party a few months ago, specifically over objections around COVID-19, around the sanctity of the democratic process and how he felt his party leaders were not protecting it. So it's even though that bill is sponsored by a Democrat, it's in a way, you know, he's a former Republican. It's sort of that conversation that's happening right now about what's going on with the Republican Party in New Hampshire in terms of there's the liberty side of things, the Liberty Caucus, and very strong anti-mandate, you know, anti any sort of COVID restrictions, and then more sort of the old school, more institutional Republicans who maybe are more moderate, maybe identify more with Governor Sununu or people like Senator Jeb Bradley, who are known for bipartisan legislation. It's going to be quite the showdown between those two bills. I don't think either one would ultimately pass, but I think the debate is going to be very spicy.
And a critical issue here in New Hampshire and elsewhere, as you know, is affordable housing. There are several bills coming through addressing that issue. Can you highlight maybe one or two of the most, what may be the most impactful?
Wow, there are so many various affordable housing bills that are coming through. And this is different in the approach from last year, when legislators tried to put a lot of affordable housing funding and incentives and training and tax credits into one big bill, HB 586. And that did not pass despite Governor Sununu's support because legislators had objected to different little parts of it. So sort of thematically, I'm seeing bills coming out that target local zoning. So for example, HB 1087 would limit minimum lot sizes that towns might be able to set. There's also bills related to tenant protection. So for example, HB 1200 would require 45 days notice before a rent increase. There will also be, as I said, affordable housing funding maybe, or other training offered to local officials. And then there's creative ideas like HB 1068, which would regulate tiny houses. That is definitely a popular issue anytime we've brought it up on the Citizens Count Facebook page. We have an article and a podcast episode about tiny house regulations that is always popular. I think that people like the idea of maybe thinking outside the box, since we're in a pretty critical shortage in New Hampshire, and it's going to take some radical action to have a housing supply that meets the workforce needs.
And finally, we have the tax proposals. No income or sales taxes, but there are bills that would affect taxes in New Hampshire. So what do we know so far?
There are a few bills related to increasing or adding property tax exemptions, such as for the elderly or veterans, but this can be tough to balance when it comes to who else is going to pay for that in a town or city. You know, if you're helping out, for example, people with disabilities, okay, then what about the elderly? They have income restrictions, but if you give elderly tax credits, well, then maybe families are going to pay more of a burden, and New Hampshire has a workforce shortage. We need to be attracting young families. So those property tax exemptions, frequent debates around those. I'm not sure there will be any momentum. There are a couple other oddball tax changes that I think people might be interested to hear about. HB 1204 would cut the rooms and meals tax again, went down this October. And then it would also increase how much of that revenue is shared with towns and cities. Very hot issue with local government officials. HB 1478 would increase business taxes, but only for large employers who pay less than $15 an hour. And that's aimed at employers such as, for example, maybe Walmart or Amazon or McDonald's, who in the past have paid very low wages and had articles written saying a bunch of people that work for them are receiving public benefits, so the government is sort of subsidizing them. I think it's highly unlikely that that sort of bill would pass with the Republican majority right now, but it's different than any other sort of business tax proposal we've seen come through. And last one I think viewers might be interested in, not so much a tax, but certainly relates to your pocketbook, HB 1426 would eliminate annual vehicle safety inspection requirements. So you might save some money on having to do that every year, which we'll see. Other states don't have annual inspection requirements, but New Hampshire has stuck to their guns on that for a while.
Well, for those interested in learning more, or whether they support or oppose these measures, what should they do?
First of all, always contact your legislators. This is a citizen legislature in New Hampshire. They get paid $100 plus mileage, and they work practically full-time for free. So I would say reach out to them, make your voice heard. You might run into them in a Dunkin' Donuts line or at the grocery store or the gas station, and they're living in your community just like you. And your voice can persuade them. It can make a difference. They're not beholden to out-of-state donors on some huge level for their reelection campaign. And if you want to find your legislators, you can, of course, go to the Gen Court website, gencourt.state.newhampshire.us. But I'm going to go ahead and plug Citizens Count, citizenscount.org. If you clicked on elected officials in the navigation bar, you can find who represents you. Also, keep an eye out for public hearing opportunities. Although there probably won't be an opportunity to do virtual testimony, you can always testify in person. Write a letter to the editor. Talk to your neighbors and friends. Tune into the Citizens Count and Granite State Collaborative News Collaborative podcast. It's called $100 Plus Mileage. We'll be highlighting lesser known legislation. And finally, follow organizations that overlap with issues you care about. So whether that's Planned Parenthood or the New Hampshire BIA or Cornerstone New Hampshire or New Futures, there's many organizations out there that are also following legislation. And if you sign up for their newsletters, a lot of times they'll let you know when there's an upcoming hearing or bill vote, and they'll ask you to contact your legislator.
Well, Anna Brown, Director of Research and Analysis for Citizens Count, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Melanie.
Conversation continues online. We want to hear from you. What upcoming bills are you concerned about? Visit our Facebook page at collaborativenh.org and use the hashtag NHPolitics. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.